So, Corona pandemic and COVID-19 is coronavirus disease 2019, as it is called. This is a disease. It's called the disease that is caused by this coronavirus. And the question is this a natural catastrophe or a man-made disaster? The distinction between a natural catastrophes and man-made disasters is very well known in psychotraumatology. Yeah? Psychotraumatologists, they know that it's a huge difference if something is done by nature, and nature might be by, like we have today, nowadays in Greece, for example, there's a huge hurricane going on there and can make a lot of damages. There can be earthquakes, there can be floods, there can be fire, there can be volcanoes, whatever what nature can do. And this, what's the result of it, yeah? It's absolutely different what we know what is result from man-made disasters. So I asked my question, this was my question. Is this corona pandemic in COVID-19, is this a natural catastrophe or is it a man-made disaster? So if we say it's a natural disaster, or raise the question, is this a natural disaster? Then it would like this. We do have a perpetrator, and this perpetrator, in a way, is the virus. And the virus is threatening victims, and this victim is the world population, because it's worldwide. So it said the SARS-CoV-2 so is threatening as a perpetrator the whole world population, makes us a victim. And then it needs the states to protect their populations in order that this virus is not killing all of us. And then the saviors, what the states say, are vaccines. And there is what I call the vaccine alliance, a vaccination alliance consisting of many institutions, the World Health Organization and Gavi and the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation and CEP and so on, many who are building an alliance here, and they say we save you from the coronavirus by vaccinations. So in case that is true, what would be the consequence? The consequence would be that we do everything to reduce fear in the population, to reduce the fear of the world population, because it doesn't help to put people much more under fear. They are afraid anyhow, because it's a killer virus and you could die from that. And so what would we do? We would do firsthand giving proper information about the virus and how it came into existence and what happened about the virus. What is about a virus? What is a virus at all? Give information about this. And on the other side, you would do some empirical studies to see how this virus can infect people and how this virus also can kill people, or how this virus can also be, how you can protect people from being killed by this virus. That means you, and how infections they transfer from one person to another. You would also engage people for empirical scientific studies, and you would try as best as possible to calm people down, strengthening them and telling them what can you do in order to protect yourself, supporting them, creating solidarity between people. Each one can support the other one. And taking people by the hand, assisting them, supporting someone to not to lose joy in life, because what we know, our immune system is, if it's put under stress, it reduces immune activities. Yeah? And the main protection against the virus, the bacteria, is the human immune system. And so we do everything. If it is really a natural catastrophe, we do everything to strengthen the human immune system and reducing stress, because when you're stressed, your immune system is not so properly working. And having joy in life, still having joy in life, is very useful for a good working of the immune system. Yeah, we would encourage each other, we would stay close together, And we would also emphasize our successes in fighting with or doing something about the virus and creating safety as much as possible. That this would be a program of reducing the fear in the whole world population. Protecting in the end, we would help each other in protecting us. This normally happens if there is a natural catastrophe. People in the country and people from international organizations, they come together and they support each other when there is an earthquake or a flooding. We know this, or fire. We know this from many, many cases. And this produces solidarity in the national communities, and even producing solidarity in international communities. So if you say this could be a man-made disaster, the Model 2 looks like this. The perpetrator in this case is the Vaccination Alliance plus the states together. They use a virus in order to threaten the world population. And then this perpetrator say, we save you from the virus. We are there now here to save you from the virus by vaccinations. And under the condition of a man-made disaster, we see that the fear is not reduced, but the fear is produced. It put people even more under fear as they even have already by lying and cheating, by threatening people, by creating images of horror, by making someone helpless, by blackmailing people, by making other people dependent, frustrating them, punishing them, isolating them, excluding them from communities, and blaming them. But so the perpetrator-victim dynamic in a human community is based on what I write here. Some of you may know my book, Who Am I in a Traumatized Society, where I describe the perpetrator-victim dynamic. And if there is a perpetrator-victim dynamic in a human community, we have all of this: lying, treating, cheating, blaming, excluding, splitting the whole community, frustrating people, and so on, and trying to people to push the people on the side, on one side, and this the perpetrator try to push everyone on his side, and convince the people that there is no perpetrator. Okay, now this is what normally is happening in a perpetrator-victim dynamic in a man-made disaster or in wars, for example. Take an example from a war, and you see war is based on lying. War is based on pictures of horror about the enemy, of punishing those who are not on one's own side, and so on. At the beginning of this corona pandemic, I thought for a while that this is a natural catastrophe. But the more I was looking what's going on, the more I looked at the media, looked what was reported, the less I could believe that this is just a natural catastrophe. The more I started to understand, oh my God, this is a man-made disaster, an instigation of someone or a group of people who do this, what I described in the Model 1. So why for me, this Model number 2 is more likely? I have many reasons for that, because there are many documents about it on the internet. If you go on the internet and with some clicks, you find a lot of documents in the World Health Organization, Gavi, the Gates Foundation, the World Bank, and there is an event called 201. The whole pandemic is planned through precisely in a way how it now is happening. I do not give references here in this lecture, but if you want to have examples for that, what I say here, and the references, I have written a book about this, is available on my internet page, in German still, yeah, in German still, with many, many references, with many documents in it. And it's now translated also into English, and maybe some month we got it also available in English. It's called Corona Delusion. I call it, meanwhile, I call this book The Corona Delusion. So, and what is the reason why I think that number, the model number two, the man-made disaster model, is more likely than the first model, the natural catastrophe? Because there are clear statements that have been made by representatives of the Vaccination Alliance that tell us this pandemic is only over if there is a vaccination available. And because this all happens as a system that uses money as an instrument of power in order to make more money. We live in a system where money is a purpose, where money is not a mean for purposes, but money is a purpose in itself, to make with money more money. And to do this, through this, in a way, crazy program, you need power, the power that is against natural desires of human beings, and it's a power that is against nature in general, because it's very destructive also against the whole nature and the whole living being on this globe. Yeah, and in a way, of course, is to vaccinate the world population, 7 or 8 billion people, is a gigantic business opportunity. If you can do this, it's very gigantic. Everyone has to be vaccinated. It's very profiting. Yeah, and because of the staging of the corona pandemic, because it is not finished yet, because it's still going on, even there is no real reason for no real death any longer, no people that really dying from this virus, it's going on and it's not finished. If it's not said, okay, it's over, it was maybe for some weeks or months it was dangerous, but now it's no longer dangerous. It's kept on going. People who do produce the pandemic, they keep on going as if there's a big risk. Even everything shows that there is no risk at all in the moment. Yeah, and how to produce fear with this COVID-19, it has many points too. The one thing is that already you call this virus, but it's a coronavirus, not only with numbers, N1, H1 or so, like it's normally done, but this coronavirus immediately is linked with death by suffocation. Then SARS means severe acute respiratory syndrome. It makes you believe that this virus is a killer virus. But in most cases, it's not killing people. In most cases, you even do not know if you have the infection. In most cases, maybe you have mild symptoms. Only a few people might die under certain circumstances. When they have already many illnesses, and then additionally maybe there is something with the virus, but nobody really knows how this really works. But it is stated as if there is a coronavirus disease that is that you can, yeah, precisely say this is coronavirus disease. Normally, if you state there is Alzheimer's disease, there is schizophrenic disease or whatever, this takes years of research and takes years to differentiate, but now, out of nothing, is created a new disease, COVID-19, and that is an illness that, on the one hand, they tell you, yeah, you can get difficulties with your lungs, but on the other hand, you also can get difficulties with your brain, you can difficulties with your liver, you can difficulties with your heart, and this shows me, yeah, that this is a panic concept. It's not a concept that, by definition of what's really going on, to see, oh, this is the risk, and it's like this is also limited. No, the idea is to tell you that COVID-19 is something that can be everything. Yeah, and everyone now who has some symptom of illness maybe automatically thinks, could this be COVID-19? If I have some problems in my body, oh, maybe this can be also COVID-19. Another argument why I think it's not really a natural disaster is the argument of the new virus. In fact, every virus is new because viruses always change somehow. Yeah, and to say that is a new virus because our immune system cannot deal with it, then you are told that you're helpless, that you have no own protection. Yeah, it is said as if every one of us doesn't have any protection against this virus. And this is, in a way, denying completely our immune system, doing as if we do not have an immune system. And meanwhile, it showed very clearly the human immune system all over the world is very able to deal with this coronavirus that, in a way, must have changed already since the beginning, because viruses always change and always are, in a way, in a fight with the immune system, and therefore they have to change. It would not make sense if a virus stays the same all the time. And then they told us there's a lack of intense care units, and if you are ill, you come in the hospital and you don't have enough lung machines to help you to survive. And then the term of triage is said. We have the medical doctors, they have to make a triage. Who is the easy case, who is the worst case, and who is the middle, and they have to decide whom to rescue or not. It never happened like this in reality. And of course, also, you know, if you put people under this extreme condition of these lung machines, only half of them survive. And this, in a way, it happened that people were under this idea. They all have coronavirus disease. They need to be on the lung machines. I think some of people have been killed by this wrong way of treating the symptoms. There are much less invasive treatments for those who suffer some lung infections than putting them in under lung machines. Yeah, and then this all the time they produce fear, and they tell us the infection, they rise exponentially and continuously, always just use these statistics that go like this, always rise. But in fact, it's depending from the tests you have, for example, that how many cases you have. And this is like this, it goes like this, it goes down, the curve of the infection goes down. But in the media, they show you curves that always rising. And in the beginning, they told us that there are millions of people will die, and the death rate will be extremely high. In fact, it isn't. The mortality rate in most cases is under the average. In Germany, in Austria, in Switzerland, it's under the average. But they tell you it's extremely high. And somehow, they also try to manipulate these statistics by, if you somebody, for example, somebody died in a car accident and you make a PCR test with the coronavirus and you find the test, then you treat them or count them as a coronavirus, a COVID-19 death. And there was a lot of manipulation. If you look closer in the to some articles, you see how much it was manipulated to get a high rate of COVID-19 death. And there's another argument that is not far away from reality when it said that infection could also happen asymptomatically. That means you are infected, not producing any symptoms, but instantly you could infect another people close to you. So that the infection is spread from persons who do not know that they're infected to another person who does not know he's infected. And though this idea of an exponential rise of the infection comes. But empirical studies show that even if you are at the beginning of an infection, you are maybe not producing severe symptoms, and you could spread some viruses in the environment. It's very rare that you have so much infectious material, so close contact, long enough to infect another person. It's absolutely rare that this has happened. These studies from Hong Kong, for example, show this, but all these studies are ignored, and the argument is infection also can happen if you just are tested with a test and this test is positive, and this moment you are infectious for everybody else. Yeah, so they make us believe, those who are the perpetrators of the pandemic, in my view, they make us believe that infection are everywhere and any time, even outside in the sun. Those who are more familiar with viruses than I am, they told me if there is ultraviolet beams, when there is sun, no virus survives. Yeah, but they ignore it. This knowledge is ignored, but auch inside the room, it's not so easy to that one person infects the others, but all this knowledge is ignored in order to make us believe that there's a huge, huge, huge danger. And so we are told that everyone could infect everyone, including children, telling that children could also infect their parents and grandparents especially. It's not true. There is no empirical evidence for that this ever happens, but it is stated. And it's even stated that if you have been infected once, had this COVID-19 illness, you can have it multiple times, and everybody could die, not only the weak and the old people. What showed, the statistics show that those who might have died from a correlation with the coronavirus, they are over the average of the life expectancy. But they make us believe that even children could die, even those who are in their middle ages, well-trained, and they bring case examples in the media to make us believe that this could be happen. And so this virus is symbolized, this corona, I think, with multicolors and the spikes everywhere. And they make us believe, oh, look at it, this is the virus and this is a killer virus. And in a way, a virus you can't see. No one can really see it, so small, yeah? Very, very, so, so small. Even much smaller than every bacteria, because it's just a DNA or RNA. And so that there is a virus is made visible in the everyday life by social distancing, by hand sanitation very often, and the wearing of the mask. And this is, in my understanding, the reason why social distancing is established, why hand sanitation is established, and the wearing of masks is established, is just to make us believe that there is the virus everywhere. And there's a huge, huge, huge risk resulting from this virus. And this should be plausible by shaping our behavior and by forcing us to wear the mask. And wearing the mask is interesting in another aspect, because this creating shortness of breath and in the end feelings of suffocation, because you're not breathing out this CO2, you breathe it in again. And the more you breathe in, the more you get a little bit dull the more you get under the condition of panic, anxieties. This wearing the mask and not being able properly to breathe brings you in a state of fear. And now you see the fear of suffocation. Oh, we can't suffocate. Now those who are producing the pandemic are putting every one of us under condition of a lack of breath and a lack of oxygen and the feeling of suffocation. Yeah, and another thing, I think the lockdown is just made in order to make us believe the danger is immense. Otherwise, one would make a lockdown, huh? Because lockdown, everyone knows all the industry, all the businesses, everything, the culture, the educational system, everything is put under the condition of nothing's happening any longer. And why are we doing this? Yeah, because the virus is so dangerous. Huh? As if to prove the danger that's come from the virus, they make the lockdown. They're producing the lockdown. And this restriction, what we now suffer from, the restriction of our basic human needs, breathing, closeness, freedom, feeling safe, is as if we have to make the biggest possible sacrifices on a personal level in order that we know, that we believe there is a killer virus. Otherwise, it would not be justified to do this. So it's upside down. It's not that we are threatened by by the virus itself, but we should believe that the virus is so dangerous by sacrificing our basic needs for our basic symbiotic needs, as I call it in IOBT, and our basic autonomy needs. It really goes against psychologically, it goes against everything what is necessary for a good life, against our symbiotic needs and against our autonomy needs. Yes, what are the goals for producing those fears? Creation of personal powerlessness. Therefore, people should hope for the salvation from outside, that comes from outside. And the acceptance of a new style of RNA vaccinations produced in an extremely short time of research. So my idea is that those who are now producing the corona pandemic, they had in mind, they want to make use of the specific RNA vaccinations, and now they produce a situation where the RNA vaccination seems to be the solution against all resistance of the traditional, or also the traditional medical system that says this is new. We do not know how this really works, these RNA vaccinations. We know from traditional vaccinations that they have many side effects, and we have to research very carefully to not to produce too much side effects. But now, telling the whole world population, it's such a risk, it's such a risk. And so, by the virus, produced by the virus, so we have to take also such a risk in producing these RNA vaccinations. We have to shorten all the research time. It's within half a year or 1 year we can produce now this new vaccine style of vaccinations. And we have to accept. And even we have to accept those side effects of the vaccination. And the state has not only to pay, the state not only has to pay for the vaccination, but also is responsible for those who have damages with these vaccinations. It's not the firms that producing the vaccination, it's the state that have to pay for the negative effects of vaccinations. Yeah, and another goal I think is if this mechanism is accepted and established during the coronavirus pandemic, the next pandemic will come, and it's easier to produce a next pandemic. There's also some saying from the World Health Organization, from Mr. Tedros, who said, yeah, there will come further pandemics, there will come further viruses, and we have to have further pandemics. That means after the pandemic is before the pandemic. If this pandemic is over by vaccinating the world population, they already plan the next pandemic with another virus. And it's very easy. If this is once successful, they will continue with it year by year. So they hope that then they can go on years, every year if they want to make a pandemic. Now it's clear how to make it, and then they will do it. So the question is, why does this way of producing fear work? Why do people believe in it? Why do people still believe this is, most people believe this is a natural catastrophe, and only a few suspect that this is a man-made disaster? Yeah, because this fear and this narrative of the corona pandemic is issues from the top. It's issues from the highest ranks of society, from presidents, from the parliament, within the countries. And you know, Macron, the French president, said, we fight a war against the virus. We are in war against the virus. Nous sommes en guerre contre le virus. Also wir sind Krieg mit dem Virus. It's coming very from the highest ranks of the political system. And it seems to be supported by highly scientific expertise from the field of virology. In Germany, I don't know if how the situation is in other countries so much, but in Germany, the only person that really is in charge for explaining population what's going on is a virologist. It's not a medical doctor, it's not an infectiologist, it's not somebody who knows something about the immune system, it's not a practitioner, but it's one person. The one person that is quoted all the time in the media, and this seems to be the only expert in the whole country. Yeah, and if you say something that is not in accordance with the official narrative, then they tell you are a danger, you are a risk for society. If you put this narrative under question, what is officially said, then you are dangerous. Then you are dangerous for the society. I was in Greece in my holidays. In Germany, it's still, you can say something. But in Greece, if you do this officially, you are punished. If you put the narrative of the coronavirus disease, as it is officially said, under question, you can be punished. Yeah. And then we have the situation in the media, and the media, the official media, in Germany at least, and I think it's worldwide in most countries, they're doing propaganda. They're doing this type of war propaganda against the virus, what means they're doing this war propaganda against everyone who is not in accordance with this official narrative. And so every day, daily, on a daily basis, you are instantly told there's the high risk and the infection rates are growing, and there is a hotspot, and there is something happening. They make you believe that there's a huge, huge risk, and who doubts it is an idiot. And there's a censorship of all opinions that do not agree, and whoever doubts the narrative about COVID-19 is socially ostracized. You are corona denier, you're nutcase, you're extremist, you're conspiracy theorist. Yeah, and another thing is why it works. It's rewarded with, it's linked with rewards. It's traditionally, it's a traditionally behavioral science, behavioral therapy. In behavioral therapy, you work with punishment and awards. And the one thing you award people, you give them money, to give them opportunities for career if they agree with you. And you threatening them and punishing those who are not in accordance with the official narrative, destroying professional careers, taking children away from the parents, and creating even a second and even a harder lockdown. If people do not agree, they threaten you, now the next lockdown will come. And the hardest lockdown in the moment is in Australia. It's unbelievable how many restrictions people do have there. Yeah, and it works because it hits the whole global societies utterly unprepared. And this is what is called a shock strategy. Yeah, you make something that is so hard and is so unbelievable that people believe in it. Yeah? So the shock strategy is always do something that is so unbelievable that people say it's unbelievable. This is a protection shield. You have to do something that is so far from beyond your imaginations that people say, "Oh, yeah, that can't be possible. That is planned. It can't be. It's impossible." So there are some people who plan such a huge, I would say, a huge crime. Yeah, and the second thing is that it hits societies that are already full of fears. We know this from our work. The societies, the people in the societies, they are a lot full of fear of death, of existential fears, fear of losses and violence. And yeah, and we know this especially from our work. There are a lot of fears, unconscious fears from our early childhood trauma. This early childhood trauma are pandemically, this is a pandemic. Early childhood trauma is real pandemically, is a real pandemic in the world population. And this triggers, né? If you are, now there's a fear produced from outside and you can't really get it, how it is, and have less access to it. And then the fear that is that triggers your fear beyond, it triggers your unconscious fears from childhood trauma. I know it from my own experiences because I did a self-encounter for myself with I and the virus and found out that this situation triggered in me a situation from I think I was half a year old when I was nearly dying from not being taken care from my parents. Yeah, this is the model to understand what I say here, that we are already traumatized. Yeah. We have still do have our healthy parts, but we have our traumatized parts, we have our surviving parts, and with this we react on the actual situation. Yeah. It can be that our traumatized parts are triggered by the production of fear. On the other hand, we know somehow already how to deal with our fears, how to dissociate, how to ignore, how not taking the situation serious, how to dissociate from our body. What also means that those who say, "Okay, then maybe you can vaccine me. It's not so worse." This is also, I would say, only if you are in your surviving parts, you have these attitudes. If you're really taking care for yourself and taking care for your body, you never would take such a risk. If you're healthy, your body is healthy and you are healthy, your immune system is properly working, why you should take the risk of a vaccination when you don't know what it does and what you don't know what the outcome is, if there are what side effects it might have? You would never do this. So only under the condition that you already split off from your body, treat your body like an object. You're used to treat your body with medications in the traditional system, then may be you also say, okay, it's just a vaccination, nothing more. Let's do it. Yeah, what are the consequences of creating all these fears? For me, it's very clear. It was also clear for me when I was now in my holidays, summer holidays. I like the sea, I like the countryside, but what I didn't like is those people running around with a mask, that you have to wear a mask when you go to the restaurant, when you go to the supermarket. And this is a huge reduction of joy of life. It's not allowed. In Greece, for example, they make dancing and chanting. It's so reduced. People are so somehow dumped down, somehow like under hypnosis. Yeah, and for me, it's a lack of joy de vivre. It's not really living in a happy way. It produces chronic stress. When I think about going to the restaurants, also here in Germany, or going to the supermarkets, I avoid it as long as possible, because I don't want, or traveling by train, because I do not want to see all these people with their mask, and I do not want to see how everybody fears each other. You have to keep distance and so on. It produces stress for me. Yeah, and though creating so huge fears creates the feeling of powerlessness and helplessness, and then this produces traumatizations. And the corona pandemic produces now trauma in the world population. And it triggers old experiences of powerlessness and helplessness. That means it produces re-traumatizations. And yeah, you see, it's the opposite of that. What they tell you, it's about your health. It's about the health of humans. Nobody should die, or nobody should take away his life chances. His chances for living as long as possible. Yeah? The opposite comes out. This pandemic makes the people in the world ill. Yeah, it produces physical illnesses and even death. This pandemic is responsible, I think, meanwhile, this pandemic is more responsible for more death that comes from the what of the lockdown and all this, than what really comes from a virus that could kill one or another person. And this creates also mental disorders, depression, suicidal tendencies, or suicides. It is eroding solidarity in relationships. It's splitting whole communities. It destroys economic resources we have. And it's creating political instability. Yeah, so we are made victims by this pandemic. Even more people than they already are victims of trauma, they now become traumatized, are made victims. The corona pandemic produces victims of trauma. So the question is, who has an interest in creating those fears in the world population? And for me, you only become a perpetrator if you have been a victim before. So those, I think, creating those fears in others who have their own early childhood fears split off within themselves, those who have experienced what they now do to others, and those who refuse to look into their own trauma biography. Only then you can be a perpetrator in this way. You know, this is my scheme of trauma biography. We start with the trauma of identity. The consequence of it is the trauma of love. In many cases, there's a trauma of sexuality. And every one of us who is the victim of a trauma in one way or others becomes a perpetrator. And what is specific in that, if we are a perpetrator, we traumatize not only others, but also ourselves. Perpetrating others. Producing trauma victims means that I traumatize myself. So in a way, there is no good psychological reason to be a perpetrator or to become a perpetrator. So those creating these fears who have been shamed as children, now they shame others. I feel ashamed if I put on this mask, I'm forced to put on this mask, I feel ashamed. It's against my honor, my dignity. And if I look at others with the face, this mask in the face, I feel them humiliated. Beside of all these physiological effects that the mask have, or the nonsense, because they do not protect you against any virus, because this windows in the tissues are far too big to prevent any virus to come in or come out. It doesn't make sense. Medically, it doesn't make any sense. Yeah? But you are forced to do this, and this is a humiliation of human beings. Yeah, trauma victims become trauma perpetrators, and another interesting psychological dynamic is going on in that, because what's done now is destructive. It's very destructive. It's destructive against pregnant, against women in birth processes, because they all are forced to wear the masks. It's against the newborn babies. It's against the children in the kindergarten. It's against the children in school. It's against our students in universities, because they have to make distant learning. Yeah, I can't go to the university in a moment because it seems to be much too dangerous to do that. Yeah, and so it's absolutely destructive. It's destructive against children. It's destructive against parents. It's destructive against those who have to work. It's destructive against older people. Yeah, huge destructiveness now that's acted out in the societies. And why do we do this? Because, of course, the destructiveness is in us. And now those who are producing these fears tell you, it's not me that is destructive, it's the virus that is destructive. So you can hide your own destructiveness behind a killer virus, but you're the killer. Another psychological explanation for that what's going on in the moment is also this narcissistic grandiosity, that some people think somehow they are in the elite, they know much better than all others what human beings need, what the world population need, and they find it a grandiose idea when they can tell the others, I save you. I'm the one that saves you. I think this attitude also comes from childhood, from early trauma, from the trauma of love, where the child wants to save the mother. Where the child thinks, I'm responsible to save my suffering mother. So I think and I believe if those who have those ideas, I have to save the world by vaccination and so on, if they come to me in therapy and they would make an intention about this, I'm pretty sure that then it will come out that their ideas in the end are the consequence of their trauma of love and their childhood trauma. And there's a highly pathological variation of this dynamic, that trauma perpetrators get excited by the fear of the trauma victims. That gives them life, that gives them some sensation, because of all the trauma they suffer and all the surviving mechanism, they numb themselves. And so the question, how to get some sensation, how to get some something that it all your body comes out of this state of numbness, and this for that you need extreme extreme stimulation. And one of these extreme stimulation is that you put fear on others, desperation on others, that somehow stimulates you. You are stimulated, very often also sexually stimulated, by the fear of the trauma victims. And that means, of course, the trauma victims outwardly will not show fear, their fears, in order not to provoke and stimulate the trauma perpetrator further. That means on the victim side, we have this situation that although this victim is under extreme high inner tension, extreme fear, extreme fear of death, on the outside, it tries not to show the fears in order not to provoke the perpetrator to go on with the perpetration. This is the, in my view, the most highly pathological variation in this trauma victim perpetrator victim dynamic. Yeah, so we have also this splitting in the perpetrators. They still have healthy parts, and they still could change their life, and they could refer to the healthy parts of the psyche. But being perpetrator means you traumatize yourself. You have a lot of guilt and shame and fear of being excluded from communities. You have to split this off, and then you have your perpetrator attitudes, where you say, it's not you that is the perpetrator, but you are the savior. And those who are not agreeing with you, they make you the victim. They turn it around. I'm not the perpetrator, but I'm the victim. And now this gives me the allowance to fight back against those who oppose against my intentions. So, as a conclusion, this corona pandemic throws the whole system into question. And I see that many people who normally do not think much about the system they live in, they now put the whole system under question. Do I continue to trust this money equal power equal money system? And if those who are on top of the society, they sell me to those who want to vaccinate me, wow, how much trust you need to have to really to continue with your beliefs in this system. So the question is, do I in the end profit from all of this? Some do. They're producing masks now, making money with the mask. But I believe that whenever you make side with the perpetrators, whenever you make a coalition with the perpetrator, you don't have a happy life. You always have bad relationships. You never know as how long these perpetrators will make use of it, or when the moment comes when you are no longer useful and you're again on the side of the enemies. So the question is, in such a system, what do I gain? Do I gain more than what I can lose in such a system? And of course, in such a situation, the question is, do I have an alternative? What is the alternative to such a system? And do I have an idea at all what a good life in a constructive society would look like? And many people don't think about it. They think it's everything is fine like this. But now a lot of people are forced to think about, is this real a good situation? Is this real a good life I'm in? But there is still a lack. What else? What else can we do? What is the alternative to this system that is so destructive? So the question is now, of course, what can lead us out of our fears? I did distinguish it in short-time measures and middle-time measures and long-term measures. In the short term, what you can do is information clarification. And what I also especially find helpful is spreading knowledge about the immune system, because we are not helpless. We are not powerless. We do have our immune system, and the immune system of the most, for the most, the whole world population, the most people in the world are, is working properly and has no problem with this coronavirus. Yeah, sometimes maybe you can also write slogans on your mask expressing what you, how you see the situation. And it's what I also find very important now in this situation is practicing solidarity within your social networks. Don't let you being first split. Keep together, exchange your experiences, exchange your opinions, be open for what the others are saying. Make the dialogue that is not possible in the official media. On the official media, you do not find that there is a dialogue between those who have this opinion and those, that opinions. We have high experts, for example, here in Germany, very, very high experts, but they are not invited to make, for example, a discussion with those who are pro-pandemic, then the public could make a decision and say, oh, who is more what is more convincing, this side or that side. So in social communities, it's necessary to discuss, exchange opinions and arguments, and have an open dialogue. Yeah, and to clear this situation with what's the basic of it, we have in our medical system, we have a traditional model. This traditional model says viruses are producing symptoms, and symptoms, they are then seen as illnesses. Yeah? The virus produces symptoms and illnesses, and illnesses need to be healed by fighting against the symptoms, what no traditional school medicine tell us. And this happens by operation, medication, even vaccination, but that normally can also produce new symptoms that need to be fought. And so it continues, all these treatments, processes, they continue. This is the traditional symptom. It is wrong in a way. I think it's very wrong, but And it also includes that the ill person is an object that must receive treatment by specialists. That is the traditional school, this model of school medicine. But now, what happens now, the coronavirus is even more primitive. Because this model tells you the virus is the infection and the infection is the illness. They do not wait long enough that the infection produces an illness, an illness that you could then treat. But they tell you, if you are infected, and this infection is proved by this PCR test, then you are ill. And they let out that you have to suffer from something in order to treat you. And that means, if you say, everybody is infectious, and everybody can be infectious, so everybody is ill. Everybody is infected and everybody is infectious. And this means, on the one side, the virus needs to be disinfected and contained, but everyone, the whole society is helpless. The whole of humankind needs to be protected and keep safe by the states and virological experts and pharmaceutical companies. So that means, in this model, every healthy person is ill or potentially ill. They tell you that everyone, even if you don't have any symptoms, any illnesses at all, and there's you have to make the distinction between infection and illness as well, because if you have the infection, your immune system is dealing with it, then you are not ill. But in this model, they tell you the virus, the existence of the virus, is the infection and is the illness. Very, very primitive model. But this has a purpose, this primitive model, to tell everyone you are ill, potentially ill. And because of these potential illnesses, the potential that you can be infected and you can be infectious, this gives those who believe in this model, gives them the allowance to vaccine you. to vaccine healthy people, children, adults, old people. Because, of course, you only can vaccine. This is also something that in the traditional medicine is clear. You only can vaccine healthy people. If somebody is ill, you should not vaccine. I'm looking forward, and maybe even this will not be hold on. Maybe they tell you everyone has to vaccine. If you are ill or not, it doesn't matter. We vaccine you. Yeah, what is the appropriate model for health and health and illness? I think viruses are stimulating the living organism to produce appropriate countermeasures. The symptoms of an infection are a demonstration of the healing response of our physical and psychological immune system. And we stay healthy by supporting our immune system. And the immune systems, you see, I say immune system. I say this physical, physiological immune system and psychological immune system. We do have both. And so we stay healthy by supporting both of it, the physiological and the psychological immune system. And the person stays a subject. In my model, what I think is a proper model about health and illnesses, in my model, the person stays a subject. It's never made an object. It's never an object. And this subject can be, if the immune system may not working sufficiently, then you can be supported by experts. But only then. Only then, if you need it, but not before. Before, you do the best you can for yourself. And I find it very interesting. In this corona pandemic, not only the medical practitioners are excluded from the expertise, they are ignored. Also, psychology is completely ignored. The effect of psychology, the effect of our psyche on our immune system is completely ignored. There's no psychological, they do not ask for psychological expertise for this primitive virus, of this primitive model of the coronavirus disease. So I find it very important to know something about the infection and the immune system, and to see how fantastic this immune system is working, because there are billions of viruses all everywhere around us, in you, outside you, and the transfer from one organism to the next is normal. We exchange every day. We exchange viruses and give information by this, giving information from one immune system gives the information to the next immune system. So it's always something. This is collectively done. It's nothing that is isolated done. This immune system needs the contact. The immune system needs the exchange with other human beings in order to be trained, in order to stay healthy. So isolating people from their communities, from their group, weakens the immune system. And also the idea that one virus, to focus on one virus out of billions of viruses, out of billions of bacteria, it's such a crazy idea. It's such a crazy, crazy idea. And the fight against one virus, it's beyond every reality of our living, how we live. So the immune system consists of an acidic membrane in the mouth, nose, eyes, and the skin. So if there is a bacteria, if there's a virus, whatever, the first barrier to come into the organism is this acidic membrane here, everywhere where the body is open, where something could invade in the body, we are protected. Normally, we are very well protected. And then we do have what is called the B cells that create antibodies to prevent viruses. If the virus succeeds to come into the organism and coming close to the cells, and trying to enter the cells, then there are specific cells that prevents that the virus goes into the cell and destroys the cell. This is another barrier. And if in case the infectious material is going into the cell, is successful in entering the cell, but then we do have the helper cells, then there are those cells who are infected, they are supported by helper cells that are under pressure, and they boost them somehow, and they risk rescue them. It's another state of our immune system. And if this is not working, if this cell can be, the cell, some cells can be saved, then we do have another stage of the immune system, the killer cells. And these killer cells, the kill cells that have been infected, they have been treated by bacteria, viruses, in order to, yeah, but to save the healthy cells, they sacrifice those infected cells and kill them. And if this is not working properly, then we have another possibility. The phagocytes, they also destroy in a certain area of infection, they destroy healthy cells together with the infected cells, and as a last option. That means you have an hurt on a part of your body where these phagocytes also eat your healthy cells around the infected cells in order to save the rest of it. Like in trauma therapies, like splitting, as the splitting something off as a last option in order to survive. So you see, we have so many useful tools in our body to protect us against infectious material, virus, bacteria, and fungi, and whatever could harm, do harm to us. Yeah. So what is necessary to be and stay healthy? If you look at this in a general way, clean air for breathing, not the reduction of your breath, not the reduction of appropriate nutrition, healthy food, enough clean water, shelter from heat and coldness, toxic substances, or also a shelter from deathly weapons, space to move, possibility to show our emotions, clear mind, a free will, healthy eye, constructive relationships, constructive social systems, peace on earth. That is necessary for being healthy and staying healthy and becoming healthy again if there's some problems. And altogether, what's very, very important for being healthy is truth. It's so necessary that we have the truth available for us and find out the truth. And wherever there is lying and cheating and betraying and not giving the proper information, that means this makes us sick. I know this from the family situation, and I know this from society. Whenever in society it started to lie and not telling the truth, it makes us sick. So, on the middle term, what can lead us out of our fears? Many people need therapeutic support. We know that. And I'm so happy that IFT work is spreading all over the globe, many, many countries. Many people like it. Many people know how helpful it is for them. And this is what I think is very necessary. And I do my best. Marta does it best. Everyone who is engaged in that does it best, to help us to overcome our fears and to go towards a healthy and constructive life. Yeah, my idea would be pausing for one day in the whole world population and having the entire world population crying and screaming out the pain of what we do to each other. Make a pause. Think about it. What do we do to each other? Pain we put on others, what pain is put on us, crying out this pain, crying, screaming out this pain, letting flow the tears one day. I think if this would be done on the whole globe for one day, our life would profoundly change on this globe. Yeah, on the long run, what can we do? We need political, financial, and health system that support self-healing capacities and skills. And what's necessary is the development of a world population that is aware and sensitive to trauma, and that declares the prevention of trauma as a primary purpose and goal. To prevent trauma, that is one thing that we should do, that we should do together. And especially prevent trauma that is done by human beings, because we can't prevent natural catastrophes to happen. They will still happen, and they are already enough trauma. They're producing already enough trauma. We do not need extra trauma by war, war against the virus, war against other countries, and so on. In the end, I ask myself, because in this corona pandemic, some people are engaged. They call themselves philanthropists. And what they're doing is philanthropy. So who is a philanthropist? Is a philanthropist somebody that produces fear? Is a philanthropist someone who treats you as an object? Is a philanthropist someone who disrespects your boundaries? Is a philanthropist who manipulates you? Or is a philanthropist someone that reduces your fears? Someone that respects your subjectivity? Someone who respects your desires and needs? And someone who is open for a dialogue with you? My answer is very clear. So there is misanthropy and philanthropy. Misanthropy is an attitude that easily traumatizes other human beings. And there's an attitude that adds new trauma to the already existing one. Philanthropy is an attitude that wants to protect human beings from trauma, that helps you to overcome already existing trauma. That is real philanthropy for me. And who is a philanthropist? I think it's a woman or a man that loves you, a human being that loves other human beings, and the constructive potential of humanity. Thank you. Okay. So far, my ideas about this corona pandemic. And if you have question now, please feel free. Write it in the chat and Marta will read it for me. And and then we can go into a dialogue and exchange our views.